weitergehen.
Alright, next up we have then Oliver, who's gonna talk to you about how Exaring, his employer, optimized their peering capacity by using source routing.
Yeah, welcome everyone. My name is Oliver. I'm going to talk about source routing on the edge, scale, reliability, and programmability for the Exaring peering on the internet. Here's the agenda. I'll short introduce myself in a moment. I'll talk about the state of packet forwarding in networks nowadays that most people do, as well as we are still doing for most of our traffic, requirements of modern packet forwarding and what we've implemented there, what we've done on the way we forward packets out of our network. I'll show you our solution on the data plane, the control plane, and maybe issues we've encountered. It depends on how much time I will have for that. And then maybe we have time for questions. I'm pretty sure we will run short on time, so maybe we won't have time for questions. If you have questions later on, just ask me outside. But I'll do my best to stay within the time window. So who am I? As I said, my name is Oliver Herms. I'm also known as Takt. I work as a senior network engineer for Exaring AG. I'm a friend of robustness, reliability, and velocity, a network automation enthusiast, and a fanboy of Golang and gRPC. And that's myself working on this project, dealing with some bugs that I've been encountering, and yeah. So, state of packet forwarding. This is how packet forwarding works these days. What you can see here is that we have a web server here on the left. It's connected to two of our core routers. There's two default routes, so the routing table here, there's a destination any, which means default route with two next hops. The core one and the core two router, so they get both equal amounts of traffic, no matter what the destination is. And then the routers do the usual shortest path routing, the way it works. So we actually, what we see here is we have multiple paths into ISPA, which is, we could see it over this IXP here, or we could also see it via ISPB. But in terms of BGP attributes, this is the best path, right? So all packets towards this destination will always take that one single path. And here comes what my problems with this are. So there's limitations of this current state. Packets to an ISP follow a single shortest path or a number of equal paths, but not all paths that I have automatically. So all active links get the same amount of traffic. So the usual vendor routers, they do ECMP, regardless of what the bandwidth on the interface is. So that means I have a 10 gig link into a network and a 100 gig link into the network, they get the same amount of traffic. So if 10 gigs go left, 10 gigs go right, there comes the next gig, one of the interfaces is overflowing already. That's a very bad limitation of current routers because it happens definitely that we have unequal links. Of course, one could say just go get two 100 gig links instead of the 100 gig and the 10 gig link, but that's not the reality. Simple as that. What is being treated as equal can be tuned administratively, but that means you have to change the router's configuration all the time. So with traffic engineering, by changing these attributes administratively, we can make sure to use non-shortest paths by moving prefixes around and say this one prefix not going on the shortest path anymore, but goes on the other path that is a less good local pref, for example, or longer AS path or whatever. But it means we have to manually tweak the route attributes here. That's not what I wanted to do. We have to manually tweak the route attributes. And that's dangerous because it can cause outages. You can leak routes, you can put the local pref too high on one port and all traffic to the one prefix suddenly goes through one interface and congests it and stuff like that. It's very bad. And we can only traffic engineer the traffic based on a per prefix basis, not per IP basis. We cannot change the weight or anything. We can just move broad ranges of prefixes around over ports. And request changes in router configs, as I said. And our router configs are fully generated. There's not a single line being made manually. So we don't want to have a system that automatically changes this configuration because we are currently still reviewing what our config generator generates. So we like to have a system that automatically reacts to congestion, for example. Also, one limitation is that all routers actually need to have knowledge of every single IP prefix. well, it sounds quite natural actually, but there's ways around it. Memory on routers is fairly limited. If I want to get the cheapest box possible that is able to do, like, I don't know, 10,000 routes, that would be much better compared to having to buy a big box that can take care of millions of routes in the forwarding ASIC. Also, for some boxes, you need expensive licenses if you want to use more than a certain amount of routes. Let's say, for example, 100K plus, you need to buy a license for that, so you want to avoid that as well. That limits the future growth of our current platform, because at the moment, we internally, we don't have the full table. We just have a few thousand prefixes, but in the future, maybe we need more, and maybe we need a full table even, and then it will not fit into our routers as well. And it stops us from buying cheaper routers, as I said. So here are requirements for what we actually would like to have. What I would like to have, actually, is a system that allows us to use all the red paths here. So use the 10 gig link on the former shortest path, and as soon as that is full, use the second cheapest link, this 20 gigs here. If this runs full, move excess traffic over to the other metro, over this other ISP, into ISPA. That's what I actually like to have. I don't want to deal with moving traffic manually around. I want to have a system that just solves the problem. Done, period. So here's the requirements. So I want to make sure that I can make non-equal speed links usable. So if I have a 10 gig, 100 gig combination, I want to use the full 110 gigabits that I have in capacity. I want to make sure that non-equal cost links are usable. So if I have two paths with different AS path lengths, for example, or different local pref, I want it to be usable without manually tweaking stuff. I want to automatically maximize utilization on the cheapest link. So it means if at some point in time in the day I need the excess capacity over a third party, I use it. As soon as I don't need it anymore, all traffic should go to the cheapest path again. So also automatically I want to move excess traffic to the next cheapest link. That involves, that's what I just said. And I want to allow to take link quality into account in routing decisions. So for example, if I have a link in a foreign network that is faulty, that has CRC errors or is congested or whatever, I could maybe see that in our application metrics and take this into account on making a decision where I send the traffic to the users. At the moment, I would have to change the router's configuration and move stuff around manually, to recognize that manually. All this should be done automatically. And I have to react to changes quickly. It has to react to changes quickly and repair any situation automatically, if possible. So the end goal is it should send something to the pager and kick someone out of bed. If the system fails, to automatically move traffic around. But that should, in the end, mean that there's nothing that can be done anymore without adding more capacity. That's the goal. So nice to have. Yeah, do not change router configs. We could make it work with changing router configs, but actually I want to avoid that. And I want to support arbitrary amount of routes, even with the cheapest routers possible. And I want to allow per IP traffic engineering in order to make sure that every user gets the best user experience we can offer. So here comes the solution. We let the vendor routers forward traffic, but not route it anymore, because they're too inflexible to meet our needs. We call all these requirements, they're not able to keep up with that. So the idea is to use source routing and let the source of the traffic make a decision which path the packet actually will take. The decision is already done when it leaves the machine. So servers send labeled packets into the network. The packets get then encapsulated into an egress into a tunnel that points to a certain egress router. So we make a decision, okay, I want to use that particular router as an egress router and that particular port. So the idea is to have two labels, basically. One label making a decision, go to that router, and the other label makes a decision, use that next stop from that router on. So a labeled packet arrives at the router, as I said. It's being statically forwarded. There's a label that indicates what is the next stop from that router, and it completely ignores the IP routing table of the router. The decision is made already. The next stop is clear because of the label mapping. Advantages of this is that that allows fine granular control of link utilization. I can send traffic around to whatever exit point I have. To everyone who has sent me this prefix, I can send the traffic, possibly. I can just make a decision in software. And this, in the end, will save OPEX, because I can move traffic from that goes to provider A to provider B that I also have a peering with before actually moving it to a transit, for example. And also, there's no need for IP routing on the routers anymore. I could drop all the public prefixes out of the ASIC. The only thing I need in the ASIC is the label information. If I see a packet with this label, where is it supposed to go? That's all I need in the ASIC on the router at that point. So I can take the cheapest box that is able to do this processing of the packets, This will save CapEx. So here's how the data plane works in detail. This example here shows a web server here that is located in Leipzig. And here's three of our core routers that actually also are peering routers. We have two ISPs here, ISPA and ISPB. These IP addresses here that you can see there, those are the next hops. And there's peerings here with 10 gigs, 10 gigs, and 20 gigs. And then on each of the routers, these next hops have a label assigned. So for example, here on core 0401, the label 1000 actually means that the label is to be popped. It's an MPLS label. And the next hop is this IP address. And quite similar, the core 01 in Leipzig has this for label 2000. It also says pop the label away and send it to this IP address. And kind of the same thing for the other router. And then we end up having this information here in the routing table of the source of the traffic. So on the web server, it says, okay, the prefix of ISPB, for example, can be sent to core 01 Leipzig 01 and core 02 Leipzig 01 because both of them have peerings here, as you see at this point. And they have different labels, label 2000 and 2001. Plus, they have a weight. So both the peerings here, they have different capacity, 10 gigs and 20 gigs. And Linux is able to do weighted cost multipathing. So we could put a weight onto the two next hops, and one third of the traffic goes to the one next hop, and two thirds of the traffic go to the other one. So it perfectly balances the traffic over our peerings then. MPLS label switching paths. So the labels that I just mentioned, the 1000, 2000, and 2001 labels, those are MPLS labels. So in every peering router that we have, we configure a static LSP like this. MPLS static LSP switch path, then it has a name. There's a transit LSP being defined. So this is the label basically, 1,018,99. This is the label is being used to use this next stop. So if we want to send traffic to 62.69.146.95. I put that label on the packet and make sure it makes the way to this particular router, and it will definitely take this single one path. Always, period. This is how I make sure how to get traffic out of that router. But to get it out of the router, I need to get the traffic into the router first, obviously. And that can be done on two ways. One option is I use a full MPLS deployment on the internal network, which we currently don't have. I would have to use IS-IS segment routing for that, LDP or RSVP. And I don't have a software stack for that to be able to receive all that information and see what the paths are, what labels I have to use to make sure that it works. Or I could just use a tunnel. Tunneling is easy. Tunneling is simple. The software for this is already there. And there's two options. I could put MPLS into GRE and then an IP, or I could MPLS into UDP and then into IP. And that's the option we've chosen because the router platform that we use does not support MPLS in GRE, but it supports MPLS in UDP. So, and the Linux box doesn't care in what it encapsulates the traffic. So this is a label stack, as it looks like when the packet leaves the machine. The first IP header points to to our peering router, where we want the traffic to leave our network. Then comes the UDP header with port 6635. That's just the assigned port for MPLS and UDP. And then comes the MPLS label that indicates what next hop is to be used. And then the gray part on the right-hand side is the actual IP packet as it leaves our network. So on Linux machines, we have to create this FOU tunnel, foo over UDP. Basically, you can put everything into UDP with that. These things that you need to do, you do the mod probe, you load the module, you define what the port is for this, this here, and then you add a tunnel interface. And we're creating automatically a tunnel interface per each and every exit router that we have. It's currently 5, soon it's going to be 7, so it's not that many. Works perfectly fine. This is one step. And the next step is to actually have the routes in the routing table with the assigned MPLS labels pointing into these tunnels so the packets actually make it to the particular router. And this is done using MPLS IP tunnel kernel module. And also, you have to make sure that the MPLS GSO is being loaded. If I have time at the end for a bit, then I will talk more about why you need MPLS GSO as well. But make sure if you want to do this, load this module. It's very important. And then you can routes can be added like this. IP route add, then the prefix, NCAP MPLS, then comes the label here. And then, yeah, we put it into the tunnel, and the tunnel name, of course, reflects where the tunnel is going. So debugging is simple. This is what a tunnel endpoint configuration looks like on our routers. There's a firewall filter that matches the packets for a certain destination prefix that is defined here in this prefix list. It matches all packets that are UDP and have destination port 6635. And then we say the action is decapsulate MPLS and UDP. So we'll just cut off the IP header, the UDP header, read the MPLS label, make a lookup, what is the next hop, and then it says, okay, pop the label, take the final packet, and forward it out to the next hop. That's just the data plane. The question is, how does all this stuff get there that's actually able to be forwarded? Because we need to get all the routes into the machines. So we'll talk about the control plane now, how that actually works. There are certain requirements on the control plane. So the control plane's first task is to calculate routing views per region. It means all machines in a region or in a POP should have the same routing view. Because I want to avoid our backbone links, obviously, because they're not endlessly big. I want to hot potato route the stuff, so I make a decision per region. That's the first requirement. The second requirement of this whole control plane is that it's reliable. It must survive machine failures, and it must support in-service software updates, ISSU. And no, this time it's not a trap. It really works. The third requirement is that it's scalable, so it must support 100 plus machines for us for the moment, and potentially in the future even way more than that. It must support growing internet routing tables, because every day there's new prefixes coming, 4v4 and v6. And it must be able to deal with a growing number of peerings, so it will see more paths in the future. So it must be scalable. And last but not least, it should be programmable, because we just don't want to make a decision on the basis on the BGP path attributes, because we have that already. We want to be able to somehow influence this thingy and make traffic engineering decisions automatically. Or for the moment, we do it manually, but there's an interface defined how to do traffic engineering with this SDN controller that we have. So first thing, getting routes from the routers. That's the first thing I need to know. Who has sent me what prefix? Otherwise, I can't make a decision, obviously. So how to make use of BMP data? We use BGP monitoring protocol for that, BMP short. BMP sends all routes to a monitoring station that the router has received from all neighbors. It sends also notifications when a peering session is being established or goes into any other state that's not established. And it can monitor. You can monitor the prefixes usually either pre-policy, so you see everything you've received, or post-policy, so you only see what the router has actually accepted. We use post-policy because we have our peering BGP filters there already, and they work quite well. I don't want to replicate them in the SDN world again. So we need a piece of software that reads the BMP packets that come from the routers. We use BioRouting for that. There's a route information server implemented that is open source, is available on GitHub. It works perfectly fine. It receives BMP messages. It tracks per router and VRF the peer state, so including the adjacency ribbon, of course, and exposes all this data via gRPC. So we can just go there and ask the thing about certain details of routes. Here's a detailed picture of how it actually works. We can see here there's a BMP packet processor in this piece of software that is here. Whenever this gets a PUP notification, it creates a router object, so here's R1. When this BMP session comes up here, it will create the R1 object here. And then it sees, oh, there's a VRF. It will create a VRF object. It sees, oh, there's PRX within the VRF. It will create a P object and its adjacency ribbons, and sort the routes that are coming from the certain peer into the structure that is basically representing this one peer. And then in the end, all the information from the adjacency ribbons, the different ones, go into an INET.0 table, which is our local RIB. That's basically a replica of R1's routing table. So the routing table from this router here is basically mirrored here. And then this one is being exposed via gRPC as a service, so we can ask it for certain things in a very fast way. For example, we can do longest prefix match, or we can dump the whole RIB, or we can do observe RIB, which is the interesting thing for us, because we want to get updates all the time whenever they come into the RIS. We want to make sure that we get the updates as soon as possible into our SDN controller. Yeah, so getting routes from the RIS into the SDN controller, it allows streaming. routing information per router and VRF. So you send a request, say I want to have the version of R1 for VRFA, and you get all the data, basically. It uses gRPC with a streaming RPC, we call observe rip, and then it reads an endless stream of updates. So initially, what we send is a full dump of the routing table of the router, and then whenever something changes, it's getting streamed through to the client. So here comes how the SDN controller works. It's time to make decisions on the data that we've received from the route information server. The route controller, or SDN controller, is written in Go, obviously. It discovers the MPLS labels for the next hop information from the EPAM. So from the EPAM, the MPLS configuration in the router that I've just shown a few slides ago is being generated. So that same mapping is being pulled from the IPAM system to get that into the controller, because the controller needs to know which next hop belongs to what label and vice versa. The controller calculates shortest paths based on BGP data per region and per prefix, of course, with the usual BGP attributes, so local pref, AS path length, MED, origin, and the internal cost to get to the next hop. So we try to avoid inter-region links. Also, it takes traffic engineering input from another system that is not there yet. That allows overriding BGP path information. So I can say, okay, although this path is not as good as the other one, and this one other path is being preferred at the moment, I can make sure that both are actually being used to do traffic engineering and move traffic to paths that have free capacity. For now, we do it automatically. For now, we do it manually, but in the future, I want to do it automatically. But this is going to be some work for, I guess, a few more months and going to take a lot of testing, because we don't want to make wrong decisions here and congest links and drop all the packets. As said, the controller is under development, but what I can say for now is it will be multi-instance with a single leader, and it takes input from OpenConfig streaming telemetry, so we get the usage statistics of the network interfaces every few seconds, so we can react quickly to congestion. We will put NetFlow information into that system to find out what traffic is actually going where, because if an interface is full, I need to know what traffic is actually there to make a decision on what can I move away, obviously. And then we need the RIS information, so from the BMP, from the route information server, to know where we can move traffic. Also, this controller then, when it has made the decision on where some traffic is going to go, so where the traffic of one certain prefix is going to go, it has to stream the routing table into the particular machine, so the machine is able to label the packets and send them out into the network. We use gRPC here again. Again, a streaming RPC, so the agent that receives the routes dials into the controller and asks, so, hey, what's my routing table? And then the controller just streams out the routing updates. A new client receives a full dump, of course, and then it gets updates whenever a route decision changed. The attributes that are being streamed out from the controller into the agent is then the prefix, the exit router's tunnel IP address, what label is to be used, and which weight the next hop actually has on the route. So here comes the route agent, getting routes into machines. It's the last task. It's also written in Go, of course. It makes sure that necessary kernel modules are loaded, so it loads the FOU module, it loads the MPLS IP tunnel module, and MPLS GSO. Once that is done, it configures the tunnels to all our routers. Routers are being discovered from data center inventory automatically, and it's periodically being reloaded. Every, I think 5 minutes, we go to the data center inventory and ask, is there any new router? And if there's a new router, we turn up another tunnel to that new router to be able to send traffic to it. It maintains the machine's routing table. It receives the updates from the route controller, as I just said, and it uses Netlink then to replace or delete the route in the kernel space. So here's the full picture of the architecture. What we can see here is we have two routers in Frankfurt here, two routers in Leipzig, then we have RIS instances, so the BMP route mirror, in Frankfurt, a few instances, and in Leipzig, a few instances, and the local routers are always connected to the local mirrors to keep the latencies low on propagating routing updates. And then there's a controller per metro, or there's actually three. All of them get the same input, so all of them produce the same output. That's the idea. That's how the redundancy concept works. The route controller then in Frankfurt makes a routing decision for the Frankfurt metro area, and the Leipzig route controllers, they make a decision based on the Leipzig routing area. And then all of them are in the local side, they're always streaming all the information to the route agent via gRPC. So the route agent gets one and the same path three times. As long as a path is being seen from at least one of the route controllers, it is being accepted. As soon as it disappears from the last one, it's being withdrawn from the kernel table, basically. And then the route agent uses Netlink to program our routing table on the machine. So here's what issues we have encountered. We had a problem with a Netlink module that is written in Go that is quite popular. It was unable to write multipath routes with MPLS encapsulation into the kernel. The ncap attribute was attached to the wrong object, basically. It's a hierarchy, and it was a layer too high. We have to move it down. Pull request is waiting for merge, but it works for us now. We had an issue with our network vendor's BMP implementation. The router was sending incomplete BGP open messages in a BMP PUP notification. So basically, when you get a PUP notification in BMP, you receive the exchanged BGP open messages. You need that in order to know what capabilities have been exchanged. Why you need the capabilities? You need the capabilities in order to decode the BGP update messages that you later get, because the NLRI format changes when you use etpath. If you don't have that, if you don't have the capabilities, you have no idea how to decode the things, and the whole thing just fails if you have etpath in the update message, but you don't know that you have actually agreed on using etpath here. The interesting thing is it only happens when we use bio-routing on the other end. The interesting thing here is that bio-routing only offers two capabilities, which is 4-byte ASN and etpath capability and etpath, and that's it. And whenever we just send these two capabilities, the vendor operating system does this mistake. And it only does it when we use the allow from statement. So with allow from, you can say, here's a prefix. I will accept any BGP session from anyone who is within that IP prefix. As soon as we use a particular neighbor statement, the problem is not there anymore. So BGP open option parameters missing. Yeah, leads to the problems that I just said. Also, I wanted to monitor the state of the LSPs, of course, to see if they are actually up and running. As soon as I had 100 plus LSPs being configured on a box, and I did a show command to actually see what LSPs I have, what state they have, it was generating broken XML. There was just simply one tag too much. As you can see here, this tag here in this line 515, that was just too much. If I drop that line, it's perfectly valid XML. As long as it's there, it's broken. Luckily, I found another command that shows the same information, plus a bit more that I needed anyways. That was working fine. Somebody on Twitter had the idea to use the JSON output. I was like, yeah, great, JSON, sounds good. It's even more efficient than XML. I used the JSON, and it was segfaulting. Ouch. And then last but not least, I had Linux issues lately. So the whole thing was running. I did ping tests with big packets, with donut fragment. I did UDP tests, and throughput was fine and everything, but as soon as I put TCP on the tunnel, on the MPLS tunnels, on Lightwire tunnels, I was just getting like 70 kilobytes per second, where I was usually getting 1.5 gigabits natively. Like, what the fuck is happening here? What I was also seeing is that interface, on the sending interface, the TX drops were increasing, but in DMESC there was no log telling me why this is actually happening. So random chunks of segments were missing, had to be retransmitted. Long story short, modprobe MPLS GSO fixed the problem. It took me 4 days of crawling through kernel code. It took me 4 days to go through kernel code and find out that actually the stem module is not being loaded. That's why it's not the handler's not in the linked list. And that's why that thing actually returned an error, minus E proto no support. But the upper layer was not catching it and not giving out an error message or anything, so yeah, it took me 4 days to find out that you need to load this module. State of rollout. So currently, we have this running on all our internal testing machines where our development app is running over, and it works perfectly fine. It's not in prod yet. Actually, I wanted to be way ahead of where I am now, but bugs came in the way, and I had to find solutions for that, so that ate up my time. We have pending deployment for dedicated SDN controller machines at the moment. They will be ordered soon, and then we will carry on. The traffic engineering controller part, that was actually the most important thing actually here in this project, is still pending, but I think we have a good basis now to carry on with this. So thank you, and I see the red light blinking here, so we have no time for questions, and I made it perfectly in time. Thank you.
We can go with one question if someone has one, so we have some time to click around.
There's one. Freddy.
Freddy Künstler, Init 7. Am I right that you didn't bother about ingress traffic at all?
Yes.
So it's completely for egress. Brilliant talk, brilliant concept. I think it, when it becomes stable, it will solve a lot of problem for the content guys here.
Yeah, it's definitely totally egress-centric and made for content networks, yes.